Greetings from University of Houston. So the discussion of today is on semiconductor nanostructures and heterostructures, and we will be focusing on the energy conversion and medical applications. So I will not be going in depth into each of the materials and the phenomena, but I would like to give an overview of some of the unique properties exhibited by the nanostructured materials when used for the energy and medical applications. So my group is basically working on development of nanostructured materials, especially oxide semiconductors, and we make we develop the new structures, and they study the properties, especially to reveal the unique properties exhibited by them, and tailor the properties to make these structures useful for particular applications. Then make devices out of that. So we primarily focus on three areas: the solar cells and solar fuels. That is for the energy conversion area. That is in the energy conversion area. And then we also develop the materials for the medical application, especially the medical diagnosis, early diagnosis of the diseases, and also for the treatment, clinical treatment of diseases like cancer. So these are some of the materials that, a few examples of the materials that we are working on or we have developed in our lab. This is a zinc oxide nanotube, nanowire architecture. Used for these applications, energy and medical applications. And these are titanium dioxide nanotube architecture. And then we work on the nanoporous architectures of WO3 nano rods of the ammonium tungstate, and then several heterostructures of the 1D materials and the 0D and 2D materials. So a combination of these materials have been proven to be very useful for the energy and medical applications. To start with, we discussed first a few examples of nanomaterials for solar cells. Titanium dioxide has been used for solar cell applications and other energy conversion applications such as water splitting and carbon dioxide conversion. The material is it is a wide band gap semiconductor. So the primary material development was done in the particulate and film form. But later when the carbon nanotubes were discovered in early 90s, there has been a lot of interest in the development of the nanotubular architecture. In addition to that, in 1995, Masuda and Fukuda reported that very highly ordered nano porous alumina could be prepared using anodic oxidation. Anodic oxidation has been known to be a technique, a low cost scalable technique for developing oxide films on metals as a protective coating. So this has been it was first introduced in 19th century, but it became popular in the early 20th century, and it has been extensively used commercially for various applications, including the coatings of kitchen utensils. Since when these highly ordered nanoporous alumina was developed by the Masuda and Fukuda, there has been interest in making ordered nanostructures of various other oxides as well. But even before these carbon nanotube, as well as the ordered porous structure development, there was a report on the development of tubular architectures of titanium dioxide that was published in Journal of Material Science in 1984. So this work has largely been unnoticed till the titanium nanotube became very popular. They prepared the titanium dioxide nanotube using anodic oxidation in an electrolyte containing chromic acid and a fluoride containing material. So the then later in 1999, Swilling et al. Also used a similar approach to make the nano tube-like architectures of titanium dioxide. In 2001, Gong and co-workers reported that pure hydrofluoric acid in water is enough to make the nanotube architecture. So these are some of the images of the cross-section and the top use of the titanium dioxide nanotube. And here you can see a image of the digital image of the film of titanium dioxide formed on titanium metal. This grayish region is where the nanotube film is. This is an array of nanotubes. It is highly ordered and it is vertically oriented. Anodic oxidation is a very, very simple process, very low cost, and it is a very scalable process. It is we just need a beaker and a power supply and the electrodes for conducting the experiment. So it it has basically an electrode where we need to form the nanostructure. So we use that electrode as anode, and then the other we have a cathode material that is material like platinum or graphite or similar materials. So the when these electrodes are immersed in a electrolyte, appropriate electrolyte, and we apply the electric field, then the nanotubes, the nanostructures are spontaneously formed on the surface of the material, the metal anode. So the nanostructure grow and consume the metal, and the oxide is the oxide nanostructure is formed on the surface of the metal. This is these are some of the images of the nanotube of nanotubes of titanium dioxide prepared by anodic oxidation in an electrolyte containing 0.5% of hydrofluoric acid in water. That's all required for the fabrication of the nanotubes. The anodization voltage is as a critical effect on the formation of the nanotubes and the nanotube structure. We can see that when we do the anodization at 3 volt, we don't get the nanotubes, but instead we get a nanoporous structure. But if we increase the voltage above 10 volt, we could see the distinct nanotubular architectures with the diameters increasing with the voltage. At a higher voltage, at above 25 voltage, the nanotubes becomes very spongy and irregular. So these are the cross-sectional images of the titanium dioxide nanotube. It is uniform over a very large area. Depending upon the size of the electrode and the size of the electrolyte bath, we can scale up to any extent. The initial nanotubes that we prepared were in hydrofluoric acid electrolyte, but these were limited by their length. A maximum length of about 500 nanometer could be achieved using electrolyte. We could not increase the length of these nanotubes. Then the Kai et al. Came up with a method to increase the length of the nanotube. So they used the pH control. The pH was increased to around 5.5 level, and then nanotube length increased accordingly. So up to around a 6 micrometer nanotube length, long nanotubes were fabricated by adjusting the pH of the electrode electrolyte using different buffer solutions. So this is the nanotube structure around 1.5 micrometer long. We can see that the top bottom part is closed and the top part is open. But again, in this electrolyte also, by pH control also, we could not gain the length more than 6.5 micrometers. So in after a couple of years, we discovered that organic electrolytes could be used as electrolyte. So we could add the fluoride fluorides in the chemical in the electrolyte, and we could combine utilize the properties of the organic compounds to increase the length of the nanotubes. These are some of the nanotubes prepared using ethylene glycol, dimethyl sulfoxide and dimethyl sulfoxide electrolyte. So these were these electrolytes were containing ammonium fluoride or hydrofluoric acid as a fluorine supplying chemicals. We could increase the length of the nanotubes from a few micrometers to hundreds of micrometers using this approach. For example, this is a nanotube film fabricated using ethylene glycol ammonium fluoride electrolyte, where we could go up to around 150 micrometer, 130 micrometer long nanotube. These nanotubes are very ordered and highly uniform. So we can see the nanotubes with a very close the compact arrangement. So this close pack arrangement, we can see here the close pack arrangement is of these nanotubes in the hexagonal form. So this while ethylene glycol could give us such a very close nanotubes, we could use other several other electrolytes to make it spaced or with a different morphology. For example, this is a nanotube film prepared using dimethyl sulfoxide electrolyte, where the morphology is slightly different from the ethylene glycol electrolyte. So we can use formamide, ethylene glycol, and a lot of other electrolytes emerge later on, and we can modify the nanotube the dimensions, morphology, spacing, the wall thickness, etc., using by choosing different electrolytes for anodization. Recently, in collaboration with Professor Anastasios Mavrokefalos at the University of Houston, we conducted some experiments on individual nanotubes. We separated this titanium dioxide from the film, and the individual nanotubes were used for the thermal, electrical, and structural studies. So there was a micro device used for this purpose, that is a four-prop setup for the electrical conductivity measurement. And we could also measure the Seebeck coefficient and the thermal conductivity of this material without changing the device. So all the three properties could be studied on a single nanotube. So what we found was that when the individual titanium dioxide nanotube, if we use stoichiometric titanium dioxide nanotube, these nanotubes are amorphous when we fabricate using anodic oxidation, but we can crystallize it by heating it above around 280 degrees Celsius. This these nanotubes, if we annihilate 400 or 500 degrees Celsius, they are very stoichiometric. And the stoichiometric titanium dioxide, the thermal conductivity is very low. But at the same time, if we introduce the defects, for example, we annealed some of the nanotubes in hydrogen ambient and then created the defects, especially Ti3 plus and oxygen vacancies in the film. And that actually increased the thermal conductivity of this material after reduction. That was not really a very unexpected result. We also found that the conductivity, electrical conductivity, increased with after creating these point defects in the material. But what was more interesting was when we reduced the temperature below 175 Kelvin, we found that the temperature, the Seebeck coefficient was changing, switching from negative to positive value. That means the material was being converted from N-type to P-type. And if we increase the temperature above 175 Kelvin, the material, the individual nanotube get back to its original N-type nature. So that was a very interesting result we found with the individual nanotubes. Believe that the acceptor state is created by the hydrogen treatment, the point defects in the gap, the region of the titanium dioxide, these acceptor states are active or are contribute predominantly at a low temperature compared to the defect states close to the conduction band of the titanium dioxide. Now we tried to develop the solar cells using this material, but the problem was the opaque substrate was a hindrance to make the devices, solar cell devices using titanium dioxide. So we developed a technology to make the nanotubes on glass. So this is a titanium dioxide nanotube film on fluorine double tin oxide coated glass. This is very transparent, and we can see the transmittance of the film after coating the titanium dioxide nanotube film. The transmittance increases and the reflection decreases. That it clearly shows that this material has anti-reflection properties because of the reduction in the effective refractive index of the media. Now the material is fabricated by first coating glass or FTO coated glass with a layer of titanium metal using sputtering. And then we anodize the metal to form the nanotubes, and then we heat treat it to make it the stoichiometric and crystalline. These are different thicknesses of the film that we used for the fabrication of the dye sensitized solar cells. So when we developed the dye sensitized solar cells using this material, so in the dye sensitized solar cells, the titanium dioxide serves as the electron transport medium where the nanotubes are stained by a dye. We used N719 commercial dye to stain the nanotubes, and these dye molecules absorb light and then transport the generate the carriers, and the electrons are transported through the titanium dioxide nanotubes. These nanotubes have a very large diffusion length for the electrons that was proven by various other groups. So that we when we used these nanotubes for dye sensitized solar cell application, we found that there is a very the quantum efficiency was enhanced because of the nanotubular architecture, especially in the low energy region or the higher wavelength region in the near closer to the red region. The quantum efficiency is very high. Now, this is very close. This region is very close to the absorption edge of the N719 dye, but because of the the scattering introduced by the nanotubes, the quantum efficiency is enhanced. So the nanotube architecture of the titanium dioxide is helping it in enhancing the overall performance of the dye-sensitized solar cell. Later, we collaborated with Professor Mohammad Nasiruddin and Professor Gradsell, Michael Gradsell and EPFL Lausanne, and developed the perovskite solar cells. So these are the perovskite solar cells we developed using nanotubes, and this is of titanium dioxide nanoparticles. We can see that the methyl ammonium lead iodide, the absorber material, has penetrated into the nanotube architecture. Then we used a whole transport material and the gold as the electrode. And these two types of solar cells were compared. And what we found was that the nanotube architecture was much better in terms of the enhancement of the efficiency and the overall efficiency. The efficiency was around 15% at that time. In 2015, when we developed this solar cells, that was the highest among all the one-dimensional materials used for hybrid perovskite solar cells. So what is remarkable for this material was the stability of the cells. So we compared the encapsulated nanoparticle based perovskite solar cells with unencapsulated nanotube based perovskite solar cell, and we found that without encapsulation, the nanotube solar cell was behaving almost the same way as the nanoparticle based cells. The degradation was almost similar, but the overall stability was better for the nanotube based solar cell, even if those cells were not encapsulated. So that means the nanotubes serve as a scaffold protecting the methyl ammonium lead, which is well known to our interaction with humidity and oxygen and the ambient temperature. So this material is becoming stable within the nanotubes. That's what we demonstrated using this experiment. Now we come to the solar fuels, use of the low dimensional materials for the solar fuels. The solar fuels are emerging as an alternative route for energy, the solar energy conversion. So the one of the techniques is to use the photoelectrochemical technique for the solar fuel generation. Though we use the photocatalyst as the electrodes, either as an anode or a cathode, and we use an appropriate electrolyte where we need to generate the fuel. And then when we shine the light and or we apply a potential between the two electrodes, we generate the fuels. For example, if you use water, water is in the anode, the water is oxidized, and we get the oxygen, and the cathode, it will be the reduced to form the hydrogen. So the oxygen and hydrogen are formed in the two separate regions. Especially, they are especially separated in this process. But the process efficiency in theory is very close to the solar cell efficiency in excess of 30%. But because of the inherent losses in the photoelectrochemical process compared to the solar cell, the practical efficiency can go to around 16 to 18%. But so far the material, there has been a lot of challenges in the material. The materials that are efficient are not stable. For example, gallium and indium phosphide based materials. So these are not really gallium arsenide, etc. So these are not really, these are very efficient, but not very stable in the the liquid and electrolyte environment, and also these are costly materials. So the other materials that are very cheap, they either don't absorb the light or have stability issues. So there has been a lot of challenges in the field, and so the technology has not yet been commercialized. So our effort has been in developing the new materials, especially nanostructured materials for enhancing the performance of the photoelectrochemical cells. So when we first tested the titanium dioxide nanotubes that we discussed earlier for the photoelectrochemical water splitting, we found that the quantum efficiency is very high. That means it could absorb, it could convert up to around 80% of the photons incident in the ultraviolet region to the charge carriers or electrons flowing through the external circuit, and that is actually proportional to the number of molecules of hydrogen and oxygen and generated. So now the problem is that above around 400 nanometer, that is the absorption edge of the titanium dioxide, there is no absorption. That means the material could absorb only the ultraviolet region of the solar spectrum, which is less than 5% of the total photon flux. So the material cannot be really efficient. So when we generated the hydrogen using these nanotubes in the photochemical cells, we got an efficiency of around 0.6%. That is because of the poor light absorption. But the material has a very, very promising properties because it could convert these charge carriers to fuels efficiently. That is why the quantum efficiency is very high. So we, in order to enhance the light absorption in the visible region, we doped the material with nitrogen. So this, we doped the titanium dioxide nanotube in situ. During the anodization itself, we incorporated the nitrogen, and then as a result, the color changed from grayish to yellowish green. And then the absorption edge also shifted from 400 nanometer to around 500 nanometer. So we used this material for carbon dioxide to fuel conversion. This is a chamber. These are chambers where the carbon dioxide is converted to fuels. We have the photocatalyst titanium dioxide nanotube inside this chamber, these chambers, and then we fill it with carbon dioxide and water vapor, seal it, and then shine sunlight, and we get methane out of the material if we use the co-catalyst of platinum. And the methane generation rate increases if we use platinum copper catalyst. So I'm not going to the details of this, but let me go to the other materials that we developed for the photoelectrochemical and photocatalytic fuel generation process. Recently, we developed a nanoporous tungsten oxide film of large thickness using anodic oxidation. We took the tungsten foil, and then we used the anodic oxidation to convert that foil to WO3, the tungsten oxide. The film is then converted into a nanoporous architecture. These are done during the anodization itself. Now we can see that in these images, the nanotubes fabricated at a low voltage, for example, 10 volt. These are very compact with a dense layer on top. We can see that this is a dense tungsten oxide. But these are not really good because these are for the efficient conversion of the water to hydrogen because the surface area is very low. And then we changed the temperature of the electrolyte bath to 550 degree. We found that the pore structure are formed. At above 60 degree, the pore structure was even lost. So 50 degree, we found that is optimum for the architecture, porous architecture. But the photocurrent was relatively low. It's almost 160 microamps per centimeter square with this these films. So what the reason was that the porous structure was very thin. But the there was a porous film on top, less than 50 nanometer, and then there is a compact layer beneath that. So this compact layer was limiting the current in the materials. Then we increased the voltage to 40 volt, higher voltages, and we found that 40 volt we could get a more porous structures, and the photocurrent increases above 1 milliamps per centimeter square, and the quantum efficiency also is high, close to 40% in the ultraviolet, and lower at the visible region up to around 450 nanometers. Now the challenge with in using the single band gap material is that when we have wide band gap materials, they don't absorb light. For example, titanium dioxide, they don't absorb the solar energy in a broad region, but they are stable. But if you use a narrow band gap material, they can absorb light in a wide energy range, but at the same time they may not be stable. So the what we did was we combined the 2D and 1D material address and make a combination of the wide band gap and narrow band gap material to find a solution to this issue. So we collaborated with Rice University, Professor Ajayan's group, and Professor Anandaraman's group in Cochin University, and we in India. And we developed the heterostructures of the new 2D material called hematine. So hematine is a 2D version of the iron oxide, the hematite. So the Rice University group, they exfoliated this material. This is a non-van der Waals material, not the traditional van der Waals material, but this is a non-van der Waals material. This is exfoliated from the hematite. And this 2D architecture was found to be very useful for the heterostructure formation. The band gap of this material is low. So what we did was we coated the titanium dioxide nanotube with the hematine, which is the 2D non-van der Waals material. And then we found that the color changed from the grayish to reddish color. And there was no really any residue on the surface of the nanotube, only a very few, but the nanotube surface was very clean. So that means the 2D material was really going into the nanotubes and getting forming a coating on the top of the nanotubes. So that means it is a 2D, 1D heterostructure. Heterostructure. The band gap was around 2.2 electron volt. That is perfect for the water splitting reaction, photoelectrochemical water splitting process. So that was basically due to the gap states in the iron oxide. So there was the increase in the band gap from the bulk hematite to the 2D hematine from 1.8 to 2.2. electron volt. But when we tried to find the position, the band positions of this material, we found that the iron oxide, 2D iron oxide the conduction band is more positive compared to the titanium dioxide, the conduction band of the titanium dioxide nanotube. Now, the implication of this is that we cannot expect electron transfer from the iron oxide to the titanium dioxide. So the idea was that the iron oxide 2D structure with a low band gap would absorb a broad solar energy in a broad range. And then we thought of, they transfer the carriers, the electrons to the titanium dioxide nanotube. That is what we thought, but we from our studies, we found that the band position percentage is not appropriate for this electron transfer. But to our surprise, when we did the quantum efficiency measurements, we did not expect any visible light, the quantum efficiency in the visible light region. For example, this red curve is of the titanium dioxide nanotube, where no quantum efficiency can be found in the visible light region above 400 nanometer. But we coat the nanotube with the anoxide, 2D anoxide, the quantum efficiency increases. So we got a quantum efficiency up to around 12% in the visible light region. So this was a surprise result. So we investigated that, and our studies showed that there was this was possible only when there was a hot electron transfer from the hematine, 2D hematine, to the conduction band of the titanium dioxide nanotube. So this 2D architecture is really helping in not only absorbing the light, but also transferring the energetic electrons to the conduction band of the titanium dioxide. We studied other materials like iron oxide, iron titanate, that exfoliated from the bulk material to form the 2D material that's called ilmenite. This was also a work conducted in collaboration with Rice University and Ho Chi Minh University. We can see the 2D iron titanate here. When we then we did the photoelectrochemical studies, but the quantum efficiency was not as high as the hematine films. That was primarily because of the residue formation on the surface of the nanotubes. The same problem we found in the case of manganese telluride exfoliated from the bulk material. So the manganese telluride also is a semiconductor with a narrow band gap. So the quantum efficiency was substantially reduced in the ultraviolet region upon coating the nanotube with the manganese telluride. This was primarily because of the formation of unexfoliated material on top of the nanotube, obstructing the passage of the light. But later, we used quantum dots of boron nitride. Boron nitride is a wide band gap material with a band gap close to 6 electron volt. It has never been used for the photoelectrochemical fuel generation purpose. But when this was fluorinated, this became a semiconductor because of the gap states formed by the introduced by the fluorination in this material. This was also done in collaboration with Rice University. So these quantum dots of a few nanometer size were used for sensitizing the titanium dioxide nanotubes. There were what we found was a remarkable increase in the quantum efficiency in the visible region up to around 25%. This was an unoptimized result. So with this wide band gap material, it's very stable material, wide band gap material, we could increase the quantum efficiency and increase the hydrogen generation in a titanium dioxide nanotube. So, our studies showed that actually the band position, the conduction band position, especially of the titanium dioxide nanotube and boron nitride, the quantum dots, the positions were appropriate for the transfer of the electrons from the quantum dots to the titanium dioxide nanotubes. Now we discuss briefly some of the low dimensional materials used for medical applications. So this is a zinc oxide nanotube nanowire architecture fabricated using anodic oxidation. The fabrication process is very simple. Instead of fluoride ions, we were using only the washing soda and baking soda, just a pinch of this washing soda and baking soda in water can form an electrolyte for the formation of the nanotube nanowire architecture of the zinc oxide. But we developed these sensors for breast cancer volatile organic compound detection using this material. So this material offers very high surface area. So they can even, they can change the electrical resistance. This is a semiconductor, so it can change the electrical resistance if the chemical environment is changed. So the volatile organic compounds, they can interact with the surface of this material, and then the reducing agents can increase the electrical conductance of this material. So the increase in the conductance is a measure of the amount of the volatile organic compounds present in the environment. So this is used for, this principle is used for the breast cancer detection. In breath, human breath, we have a lot of different volatile organic compounds, and these are generated, or the concentrations are increased depending upon the physical condition, the disease state of the body. The diseases like a cancer can introduce the new volatile organic compounds, but these are in extremely small concentrations. And also the complexity is very high. We have to detect these volatile organic compounds from hundreds of other compounds present in the breath. The nano materials can address this issue because they can provide the high surface area for the absorption and then amplify the signal very much. So we can detect even a very small amount of the gases. The titanium dioxide nanotube formed by anodization was the process was very interesting. So initially the nano rods were formed during the anodization, a few seconds of the anodization, and then the pits are formed on the top of the nano wires, and the nanotubes are then formed after that. This process is completely different from the titanium dioxide nanotube formation. So this is a heat-treated nanotubes architecture. So then we used for the sensing application, we found that this material could really detect the biomarkers for breast cancer. These are acetophenone, isopropanol, leptinol, and isopropyl myristate. Those are the four compounds we tested in addition to many other compounds. But we found that this material has response to these compounds much better than any other compounds. And these are, the response is very stable. Even if you cycle the environment, we can get the same response from the material. So recently, we studied the VOC sensing, volatile organic compound sensing properties of the graphene films prepared from natural citrus oil or natural orange oil. This was a work done in collaboration with Professor Jacob in James Cook University. So this graphene films were prepared using the plasma assisted chemical vapor deposition. But we found that this material has, these graphene films, vertical graphene films have nano union structures embedded in them. So these materials were found to be very useful for acetone detection. Acetone is also an indicator of diabetes, diseases like diabetes and the cancer. Lastly, we developed a material called ammonium tungstate nano rods, and we used for photothermal therapy. Tungsten oxide has a relatively wide band gap, so it absorbs only the up to around blue region of the solar spectrum. Now, the ammonium tungstate nano rods, they could absorb light less than around 600 nano, in the blue region as well as in the red region. So above 800 nanometer, it could absorb the light. Now, what is important with this 800 nanometer or above is that this is a region where the infrared or near infrared has maximum penetration depth. through the tissues. So it can go to around 4 or 5 centimeters, the near infrared radiation. So we have the ammonium nitrate as absorptions in this region, and that we wanted to utilize for the photothermal therapy. These nanotubes were not really biocompatible, so we coated with polyethylene glycol, PEG. So these here is the EDX map of the nanorods. We can see that the tungsten, the green is a tungsten everywhere in the nanorod, and then the purple shows the ethylene glycol or the carbon in the film. So that means the ethylene glycol is uniformly, polyethylene glycol is uniformly distributed over the surface of the material. This is an external structure. So when we irradiate this material with a laser, it could locally increase the temperature suddenly to, in a few minutes, less than 2 minutes, it could increase the temperature to above 60 degrees Celsius. So when the temperature goes around 47 degrees Celsius, the cells can be destroyed. And we utilize that for the cancer cancer treatment. So we when we shine the material with a laser of 1 or 2 watts per centimeter square, the temperature increases. And when we switch off the laser, it will come back to the normal. The time constant is around 100 seconds. So this is very repeatable. The pattern is very repeatable. The switching on and off of the laser increases the temperature and reduces the, then when it is off, it the material cools down. Here is the image of the breast cancer cells, two cell lines used as SUM-159 and MCF-7 cell lines, where human breast cancer cell lines were used. And the top row shows the control. These are the controls, and the bottom row shows the breast cancer cells mixed with along with the ammonium nitrate nanorods. What we could see is that after irradiation, this is unirradiated, there's no difference, but when we use 1 watt per centimeter square, there will be a few cells destroyed by the photo necrosis. But when we increase the temperature to, the power to 2 watts per centimeter square, the most of the cells are destroyed through rapid photo necrosis. That means that this material is very efficient for the photothermal therapy. We found the efficiency, we calculated the efficiency to be around 32.7%, which is much better than many of the materials used for the same purpose. So summarizing my talk, I just presented a few examples of some of these nanoscale semiconductors that are really promising for energy and medical applications. So they really offer different promising pathways for addressing the challenges in the areas of solar energy conversion and clinical diagnosis. We also demonstrated that the electrochemical anodic oxidation, solar thermal synthesis, so we developed the ammonium tungstate film using solar thermal synthesis. So, and also we formed the structures of titanium dioxide with the 2D materials using the solar thermal technique. So these techniques are really useful for developing new ordered one-dimensional nanostructures, porous films, and heterostructures. The nanoscale feature size and the surface area, especially the wall thickness or the dimensions of the diameter of the nanowire or nanorod, these are really important in tuning the properties of the materials, electro-optical properties of these materials. We can also form the new heterostructures from the one-dimensional, two-dimensional, zero-dimensional materials and their combinations. And in, I think future focus must be on the multinary materials and heterostructures for solving the outstanding issues in the areas especially in the area of solar energy conversion, for this technology, like photoelectric chemical fuel generation, water splitting as well as carbon dioxide conversion to be commercially viable technologies. Thank you.